Hello, my name is Jalen Kloosterman and I'm going to explain to you the neutron diffusion equation that can be used to calculate the power profile in a nuclear reactor core. First, we define the neutron flux density, sometimes also called the neutron flux. In contradiction to other fields in physics, the neutron flux density is not a vector but a scalar. It's equal to the product of the neutron density and the velocity of each neutron. Therefore, it can be viewed of as a total path length traveled by neutrons in a unit volume. Typically, the neutron flux density is depending on space, energy and time. For simple applications with no energy dependence, the one group approximation can be used, in which it is assumed that all neutrons have the same energy. In the remainder of this video, we will adopt this one group approximation. The definition of the neutron flux density is illustrated in this figure. Suppose we have an arbitrary volume traversed by neutrons. If we count all the segments of the neutrons per second and divide by the size of the volume, we get the neutron flux density. It's the total distance traveled by neutrons per unit volume and per unit time. In the previous movie, we've learned that a macroscopic cross-section is the interaction rate per unit distance traveled by the neutrons. On the previous slide, we've seen that the neutron flux density is the total distance traveled by all neutrons per unit volume and per unit time. This means that a product of these two factors gives the total number of reactions per unit volume per second. This parameter is called the reaction rate of the neutrons. Because the neutron flux depends on space, energy and time, and because a macroscopic cross-section typically also depends on space and energy, the reaction rate is also depending on these parameters. Because a macroscopic cross-section can be split into the individual contributions due to neutron capture, fission and scattering, also the reaction rate can be subdivided into these separate contributions. The units of these partial contributions are the same as for the total reaction rate. And the sum of all partial reaction rates is equal to the total reaction rate. Now we will derive an expression for the leakage of neutrons from a volume element. For simplicity, we will derive this expression in one dimension first. Imagine neutrons streaming from left to right. If the neutrons streaming out of an element delta x is larger at the right boundary than at the left boundary, there is a net positive outflow of neutrons. The leakage per unit size of the element delta x is equal to the derivative of the neutron current called J. On the next slide, we will derive a simple expression for the neutron current based on Fick's law. Now we will derive an expression for the flow of neutrons from one region to another. In diffusion theory, the transport of particles is described as being proportional to the gradient of the particle number density. In reactor physics, this would translate into a neutron current density that is proportional to the gradient of the neutron flux density. The formula for J gives the expression in one dimension, namely in the x direction. We will now derive the neutron balance equation in diffusion theory by looking at each loss and gain term in a unit volume. Left of the balance is the time derivative of the neutron number density. If this time derivative is zero, we have a stationary neutron flux, otherwise it is increasing or decreasing in time. The first term on the right-hand side describes the flow of neutrons in the x direction. We would have similar terms with y and z in a three-dimensional problem. The term in blue between brackets is the neutron current density in diffusion theory using Fick's law. Note that we have two minus signs here, because the leakage is counted as a loss term in the balance equation, which adds another minus sign in front of it. The second term on the right-hand side is the absorption rate of neutrons, which is also a loss term, and has therefore also a minus sign in front of it. And the third term on the right-hand side is the fission neutron source term. This is equal to the fission rate multiplied by the average number of neutrons in a fission event, indicated by nu. For most reactors using uranium as a fuel, nu has a value of about 2.5. This equation shows the same expression for the three-dimensional case, where the d phi dx is now replaced by the Nabla operator. Nabla stands for the three-dimensional derivative in both the x, y and z directions. If we would have a homogeneous reactor, the diffusion coefficient would have no spatial dependency, and the equation would become as in the lower line. There is one important step to make. In the design process of a nuclear reactor core, it would be very difficult to find the fuel composition that would make the reactor exactly critical, and the neutron flux density independent of time. Therefore, we apply a trick. We adapt the production of fission neutrons a bit, such that the production balances the leakage and absorption rate of neutrons. For this purpose, we add the factor in red, 1 divided by k, in front of the fission neutron production term. K is equal to the production of neutrons in fission events divided by the loss of neutrons due to leakage and absorption. It's therefore equal to the effective multiplication factor that we've seen before in the video on the neutron life cycle. From the neutron flux density, we can calculate the power density in the reactor core. There is a simple relation between the neutron flux density and the power density, by first calculating the fission reaction rate and multiplying this rate with the energy release per fission. Thank you for your attention, and I hope to see you back at the next video.